invite y'all to please stand for the reading of the Advent.
The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will fulfill the promise I made to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. In those days and at that time I will cause a righteous branch to spring up for David, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In those days Judah will be saved and Jerusalem will live in safety. And this is the name by which it will be called: the Lord is our righteousness.
Let us pray. Faithful God, out of death you bring life. Renew us in hope that we may be alert to the burgeoning of Christ's advent among us. God of promise, God of hope, into our darkness come. Amen.
Amen.
Gloria, you know that Advent, we're starting Advent, obviously, this beautiful, whoever decorated, y'all rock. Amen? Come on, let's, oh my goodness. If that doesn't put you in the Christmas spirit. We are in Advent, which means not only are we celebrating the birth of Jesus Christ, but we're looking forward to his coming again. Amen? So it's not just that he came, but that he's coming. Woo! Amen. That is awesome. So I want to, today is celebrating hope. And without hope, we can't have faith. Hope is like the foundation stone of faith. So I hope you're putting your hope in the right place. And if you're not, I pray that you would turn to Jesus and put your hope in him. Amen? Amen. Let us continue to worship. I'm going to get my capo in the right place, and we're going to keep worshiping.
My heart grows cold and my flesh is failing. The Spirit is willing to point me back to you. For to live is Christ and to die is better. Help me remember my song to you in all.
All that I am, my life divine.
Jesus, thank you so much. Thank you for your presence in this place. Thank you for the hope that you give us in Jesus Christ. Sometimes our days get dark. So I pray that you would pour your light into those people who have the dark days right now and give them your hope. God, we love you. You are our hope. You are our provider. You are our protector. You are our healer. You are everything. So I pray that you would pour out your spirit to us here today. We're not just here just to do our duty of being in church. We're here to encounter you and your presence. And Lord, we're here to worship you not only in spirit and in truth, but we're here to worship you with our tithes and our offerings. So I pray that you would take those tithes and the offerings and pray that you would multiply it, you would bless it, that you would use it to further your kingdom. Lord, we have this year-end offering, and I pray that you would put on our hearts, put on my heart. I know I'm still praying for that amount to give. God, you use it in so many awesome ways. Let this house be a lighthouse for Denver. I pray for your blessing over the parade and how that outreach is going to work and how people will feel love from this house. What a blessing. So use us for your glory. We love you. It's in your holy name we pray. Amen. Canaan is a place. Canaan is an actual place, but in this song, Canaan is that promised land, that place, that purpose that he has for you. Did you know that God gave each and every one of us a purpose? We're here for a reason, and part of that reason is to love. Even handing out hot chocolate, that's love on a cold day. Amen? Love on a cold day. So this week, as you go through your week, find a way to spread love. Find a way to love someone that's hard to love. As you go into your Canaan. You said to go to Canaan, into your promised land. Should follow your path. It's anointed by your hand. You're so good to me. You're so good to me. You fight my battle. So good to me. Thank you that you do fight our battles, that you tell us in Exodus 14:14 that you will fight for us when we need only to be still. There are times that we need to go through a process, but there are also times that we need to just be still and seek your presence, and we're seeking it today. Lord, let your presence be in your word. Let your presence be in our worship. Let your presence be thick today. God, I want to lift up our pastor. I pray that your anointing will fall on him and your favor would be over him, Lord, and that you would speak through him. Our hearts are prepared, Lord, for your word. Speak to us in a powerful way today. Lord, we love you. We praise you. We do give you honor and glory. It's in your holy name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Well, good morning, church. It's good to see each and every one of you here today. I don't know if we've ate too much turkey or what it is, but just seems like there's a quietness. You still with me out there? You're not asleep, are you? Okay. All right. Well. Again, good morning. I want to welcome you. This is the first Sunday of Advent, okay? And Advent, of course, is the Sundays that leads up and leads us through to that journey to Christmas. And each Sunday, we're going to be lighting a candle, an Advent candle in celebration. We're also going to be doing a series in Advent this year, and as we're going to travel the journey through the Bible from the announcement to the arrival of what some know as the wise men, or more appropriately known as the Magi. So I invite you to join us each Sunday as we begin to witness His Majesty.
There is a silent ardor that arrives at one's first child. Every mother is quite worried. When one is young, one prays. When one becomes a mother, one burns the midnight oil. You know what I speak of? A hip gifts for my first child. Mary was such an easy child. And then she met this quiet carpenter, nice enough young man, that her father and I worried she could provide. That soon became the least of our worries. She came to me quietly one morning, talking of angels and God, trying to explain the child that she had conceived. Mind you, every Jewish girl's dream is to be chosen to give birth to the one. You have it out of here. Listen. It's one thing to conceive out of wedlock, but this story she lied to her own mother. What have you done? I said to her over and over. I screamed. Words that haunt me every day. This is how I greeted the long-awaited savior of our king. But when I finally understood, when I finally believed, an ecstasy spilled out of me. Have you been there this whole time? I was to be the grandmother of the Messiah. I don't know what I expected after that. Perhaps a more suitable birth plan for our king and his mother. What do I know? I know this. The very first thing I said to my sweet Mary was, "What have you done?" Such a useless question. What I should have said was, "Let's see what God can do."
Specifically mention Mary's parents or her mother, and it's reasonable to assume, however, that her mother and father were really intimately connected with her life and the sharing of their faith with Mary.
In the Gospel of Luke, we read these words. It says that in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town called Nazareth to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and he said, "Greetings, favored one. The Lord is with you." Now look at that passage of scripture. Greetings, favored one. Favored one. Now that would suggest that the Lord saw something in Mary, okay, as one who was righteous in the eyes of the Lord. Now to me that suggests that Mary had been brought up in the teachings of her faith and been taught about God by her mother or parents. Now last week we had the baptism of Everly, and I mentioned that Drew and Angie, as well as this entire church, we took a vow. And that vow was that we would teach this child in the understanding, and we would live according to the ways and the teachings of Christ, that when the time came that Everly would embrace not only her baptism, but would embrace her faith and come to know Jesus Christ as Lord of her life. Well, the Jewish family was taught the same thing. Early on, the Jewish families, they would take a vow and that they would pass on their faith, their stories to those generations. From generation to generation, they would teach of how God had freed them from Egypt, teach of how God, Moses had led them across the wilderness, how Joshua had taken them across the Jordan River into the land of Canaan. Teach them these stories. And while Mary had a very unique calling from God on her future, the scripture reminds us that Mary and her parents, they had other ideas. They had other expectations for Mary and for their daughter, just like any parent would. Now, the scripture says that Mary was engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. marriages at the time of Mary at this time. They were arranged marriages. They would have been arranged much younger. Mary may have been as young as 14 years old when the angel visited her. And Joseph would have been much older. Now families would come together and they would arrange these dowries or they would arrange this agreement. And when the agreement was met, then Mary's family and Joseph would announce the engagement. The man in this case, of course, we know is Joseph. And the scriptures tells us that Joseph was that of a carpenter. Joseph would have been older because, see, they wanted to make sure that Joseph could care for Mary and also provide her a home. Like any mother, Jewish mothers are not different, any different. They had hopes for their daughters. Their hopes were like any other parent. Their hopes was their daughter would grow up to be a good wife. At the time of Mary, that's what they hoped for, that they would have a good husband and that they would become a woman who would bear children for their husband. And hopefully one of those children would be a male child so that they could carry on the name. And in doing so, this would bring honor and glory and dignity to the family. And they would be seen as being righteous in the eyes of God and also in the eyes of the community. But along with those dreams, every Jewish girl had another dream. And that dream was becoming the one who would give birth to the Messiah, the favored one. The one that was prophesied by Isaiah in the scriptures that said, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Look, the young woman is with child, and she shall bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel." But time passed, and mothers would then pass that story on to their daughters, and that dream on to their daughters. But yet, I expect, like many of us, over time, they really didn't expect that prophecy to come true. It was just a story that had been passed down from generations to generations to generations, much like the story of Christmas that we share. It's just a story. So it was only natural that Mary was much perplexed by his words and pondered, well, what sort of greeting this might be. You see, while it may have been God's plan for Mary, Mary seemed a little taken back, if you would. There's a little apprehension on her part, or maybe fear could be seen on her face. So the angel seeks to bring her some comfort and says, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. And he will be great. And he will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there will be no end." Well, you know, that's certainly a lot to put on the shoulders of young Mary. And while it may have brought Mary some peace, some comfort, maybe, I mean, at least to know that God had great plans for his son, that all was going to turn out well for Jesus, Mary still had some questions. Well, how can this be since I'm a virgin? Now, I want you to focus. Leave that up there just a moment. I want you to focus on those words, "How can this be?" Because we know Mary's story is much different than our story. There's only been one virgin birth. But how can this be, those words? I expect we've all expressed those words, or at least thought them, at one time or another in our lives. Lord, how can this be? How can this be? While whatever we were, or maybe whatever we are facing now, and maybe it's not on the same level as Mary's news, Mary's remark, it sort of mirrors those questions that I know that I've asked myself and asked of God. Lord, just exactly, how is this going to come about? I can't see it, Lord. How, God? How? And I expect you probably said the same thing if you're really honest with yourself. I mean, we hear those things and we say those things, Wes. Well, you just got to trust God. Just give it to God. Trust God. Well, that's easy to say, isn't it? But how about when it comes time for us to really step out of faith and trust God with our future, with the plans for our lives? I wonder how many of us would actually take the leap of faith that Mary did. I just wonder. But you know what? I do take comfort in knowing that God understands. God understands that we question and we ask, how can this be? And I believe that God understands that apprehension on our part. And if we lead with our heart, I believe that He gives to us some affirmation along the way, so that we begin to follow that plan that He has for our life. I mean, look at what the angel tells Mary when Mary questions. The angel came to her and said, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. And therefore the child to be born will be holy, and it will be called the Son of God." Well, that's the how part, isn't it? I mean, it appears that all the details are worked out, that much of it anyway. But I really expect that upon hearing this, that Mary wasn't truly satisfied and that she still had some reservation on her part. I mean, think about it. The angel had shared up to this point. That's a lot to grasp. The Most High God. And perhaps part of the problem is that Mary's like us. Mary's a human being. Flesh and blood, and we don't understand God's ways. God's ways are higher than our ways, and sometimes we just have to trust and put it in the hands of God. So the angel continues and says these words, says, "And now your relative Elizabeth, who is in her old age, has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren." You know Elizabeth, don't you? Go home and look at the Gospel of Luke and read that story of Elizabeth and how all that came about. And then after Elizabeth conceived, we're told that she remained in seclusion for 5 months, and then you'll pick up and it says, in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel came to Mary with the news. And the angel also tells Mary about Elizabeth. Now imagine what it must have been going through Mary's mind at that moment, if you will. Are you kidding me? I mean, they were good Jewish people. And the good Jewish people, they always went to Jerusalem at least once a year. And so the family probably gathered in Jerusalem, and there they saw Elizabeth year after year after year after year, and no child. And she finally got to that age where you didn't even expect her to ever have a child again. And suddenly, she's with child. Mary might have even thought back, you know, there was another story that I remember my mother telling me, and that's the story of Sarah in the Bible. You remember Sarah, don't you? The angels come and said that Sarah had promised that Sarah would have a child. And you know what Sarah did, don't you? Well, she laughed. You've got to be kidding me. As old as I am, a child? But yet, she had a child, didn't she? Isaac was born. You know, I'm still that Mary, sure that Mary had still a lot of questions on her mind. And one of those might be, how in the world am I going to be able to tell this story? How in the world am I going to be able to go to my mother and say, "Mom, I've got some news. You better sit down." How was she going to be able to share that? Now, we don't know exactly how Mary told her parents. There's no way of knowing about God's plans. But stop for a moment and think about it. Who in the world would believe that story? It said that in the video. Who in the world would believe that? Mary, you're making up another story again. You're lying to me. Mary, what happened? Why did you lie to me? How could you have disgraced us? I doubt the portrayal in the video was too far-fetched from what possibly the reaction was. No doubt Mary's parents experienced that range of emotions. You know, they were like any other parents who suddenly had their dreams changed. This is not the way it's supposed to be. I recall a time, you know, it's very different. My mother made the announcement. She said, I'm going to sell everything I've got, and I'm going to the Samoans, and I'm going to be a missionary. People started laughing. Some people said, well, you've got to follow what God's called for you. And others just looked at her. Most of them looked at her and said, you are absolutely crazy. You're crazy. You've lost your mind. In Mary's case, though, there was a lot of other emotions going on here, and I expect some of that was fear. What are people going to think, or what are they going to say? How are they going to react? And what about my future? What's going to happen to me in the future? And Joseph, how's Joseph going to take all this? How can I explain to him? So many unanswered questions. I shared with you, Elizabeth hid herself for 5 months. She didn't want to show anything. So I expect Mary's mother was figuring out, how can we hide her? How can we hide her? The scripture says they sent her away to Elizabeth. Hide her from the embarrassment of those who'll never understand or even try to believe her story. And mixed in all these emotions, there's a joy. There's a joy of knowing that my child, God has found favor in my child. My child is going to give birth to the Messiah. All that. I expect that Mary's mother probably needed some time to process what was going on and come to terms with all that her daughter had shared with her and about her impending grandson who was from God. But they always knew that Mary's fate really lied in the hands of Joseph, how he would react. You know, sometimes people, when they hear things that happen, they need a minute or two, or sometimes they need months to discern what's going on, and sometimes they even need years to align their lives with unexpected news. However, if God could do what he did inside of Mary's womb in the formation of his immaculate conceived son, God could work in the heart and the life of Mary and Joseph and Mary's mother and in our lives as well. What the angel said to Mary went far beyond her life and unique situation. For nothing will be impossible with God. Now, no doubt, Mary was sharing her story with her mother, and her mother was listening to this, and to come to that where the angel says, there's nothing impossible for God, that Mary's mother finally just looked at her and said, well, Mary, what did you say? And Mary said, well, I said, here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word. And then the angel departed from her. Now from that moment, I can only begin to imagine Mary's mom. Mary's mom began making these preparations for this new baby. We've got this baby coming. We've got to prepare for it. I don't know how it's going to be. I don't know what's going to happen, but this baby's coming. What are we going to call him? Well, we're going to call him Jesus. Where will he live? Well, I don't know. What will he become? He's going to become the King of Kings, Lord of Lords. I wonder how many times that Mary and maybe her mother, along the way, they had to keep reminding themselves, nothing is impossible for God. Nothing is impossible for God. Well, how often have we chosen to walk with God? And it seemed like no matter what we did, no matter how hard we worked to make everything absolutely perfect because we're doing it for God, and it messes up and falls apart, and we have to keep reminding ourselves, God's got this. God's got this. How many times have we said, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Lord, I will follow you. But what we were really expecting was the journey to be easy and that path to be straight and no problems along the way. History does not record it, and Scripture does not record it, but it's reasonable to believe that sometime along the way that Mary's mother likely met Jesus. She may have even held him in her arms and witnessed for herself, as the video portrayed, the majesty of Jesus. You see, the story became real. No doubt she recalled the story that Mary had shared with her, that the child to be born will be holy and will be called the Son of God. There in her arms was the Son of God. Yet he looked like just any other baby. Imagine the love and the emotion that Mary's mother must have felt at that moment. What God was in the process of doing was far beyond what Mary's mother or anyone else could even begin to imagine. In fact, what God was going to do could only be categorized as the ultimate gift. The ultimate gift for Mary, the ultimate gift for Mary's mother, and the ultimate gift for the world, God's only Son. If you recall in the video, Mary's mother says these words. She says, "Let's see what God can do." As I said, while we actually have no record of Mary's mother, we do have the words of Mary, where she surrenders herself. She yields herself completely and fully to the will of God. And what I see that as a testimony. A testimony is how Mary was brought up by her family. Later in years, we go to 2 Timothy, well after the resurrection. We find Paul's words to Timothy, and he says these words. He said, "I'm reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that lived first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now I'm sure lives in you." The story became real. So we don't really know about Lois or Eunice, except that they passed their faith on to Timothy. Just as I expected that Mary's mother passed her faith on to Mary, preparing her for the role that God had for her in her life. You see, throughout this Advent season, what we're going to do, we're going to examine the impact of the Christmas story upon people with whose lives are ordinary. They're not seen in that nativity scene that we put out every Christmas. The shepherds or Mary and Joseph or the wise men or magi. But in others, that the story became real to them. What I want you to think about today is, what impact has that story had for you? Has the Christmas story really become real for you? Or is it just that? Just a story that we sit down in December and begin to tell? What impact has Jesus had upon your life? Is there a time in your life when God did something or that you really didn't expect for God to do? Have we been faithful to prepare our children and even our grandchildren to be willing to submit themselves fully and completely to God? Have we truly submitted our lives completely and fully to God? Are we willing to accept the path that our loved ones may travel following Christ, even if it's not according to the plans that we had for them? Can we say, as that actress did in the video, let's see what God can do? Let's give it to God. Let's see what God can do. You know, God found favor in Mary, and Mary allowed God to use her to bring his only son Jesus into this world. And as a result, the shackles of sin were broken and the curse of death was overcome. So as we move closer and closer to celebrating the birth of Jesus, how might you allow God to use you to bring about His will. God doesn't need another virgin birth. But what He does need is He needs you. And He needs me. To testify to what Christ has done in our lives. What is God calling you to do? What have you avoided doing? Telling yourself, oh, it's impossible. Or asking, how can this be? Perhaps now is the time for God to take what you think is impossible and let Him make possible. Maybe today or maybe during this Advent season, you'll be able to say, here I am. The servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word. Let's pray. Gracious God, this is not just a season. But Lord, this is a life changing, a life altering, a life transforming period. Let it not just be a story that we tell and that we share and that we move on to, but let it become real. Real for us and real for those around us. Let this be the time that your glory shines into all the world. That they may be drawn to you. And we pray this in the name of Christ. Amen.
Amen. Let's all stand and worship.
Love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.